welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear stories from Jill Robbins and Mario Ritter, Jr. Later, John Russell and I bring you today's health and lifestyle report. We close the show with the lesson of the day. But first, here is Jill Robbins.
A playhouse in London, Britain, and a theater from Osaka, Japan, are working together to prove cultural differences between the two countries are only on the surface. London's Charing Cross Theatre and Osaka's Umeda Arts Theatre first worked together on a performance in 2019. After a break caused by the pandemic, they are jointly staging two plays in London this month. The plays are rooted in Japanese culture and deal with secretive relationships, but the concerns are universal. Actor Susan Momoko Hingley spoke of Japan's export of culture, including films and television series. She told the Reuters news agency, "It's really about getting great stories from all sorts of different cultures to Britain and to the West." She stars in One Small Step, written by Takuya Kato. It tells the story of a couple working for a company that is colonizing the moon. The plot becomes more complex with the news the woman is pregnant. It raises concerns audiences almost anywhere can relate to about motherhood, career, and inequality between men and women. Kato, who is also the play's director, said, "In terms of equity, I think nowadays many people often say that we are striving for fairness within companies, within societies, and between individuals. But I think it is something that we understand with our heads, but might not necessarily grasp it with our hearts," he added. The London production, Kato said, gave new life to his play at the intersection of two different cultures. He noted that for Japanese creative industries, the market within Japan may not be enough to support them. Working with companies in other countries helps the theater companies and expands knowledge of the culture. "If we don't grow the part of co-productions, which we have traditionally struggled with, it would be difficult to survive as both an industry and culture in the future," he said. Following One Small Step, which runs until October 9th, Charing Cross Theatre will host Tattooer later in the month. The play, by another Japanese writer, Takuya Kaneshima, tells the story of a tattoo artist. I'm Jill Robbins.
Two Americans have won the 2024 Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine for their discovery of genetic material called microRNA. Victor Ambros is a professor at the University of Massachusetts, and Gary Ruvkin is a Harvard University professor. The Nobel Assembly at the Karolinska Institute, a group of 50 professors, decided to award the two for identifying genetic molecules that help control how genes work. The Nobel Assembly said the discovery is proving to be fundamentally important for how organisms develop and function. In explaining the importance of the work, the group said it revealed a completely new principle of gene regulation that turned out to be essential for multicellular organisms, including humans. RNA takes genetic information from DNA through a process called transcription. RNA then becomes involved in protein production or other activities within the cell. Ambrose and Rufkin found that microRNA, or very short chains of molecules, are needed for normal genetic development. The committee said changes in the way that microRNA functions can lead to major genetic changes, or mutations, over time. Nobel's website said the changes can lead to diseases such as cancer, diabetes, and autoimmune diseases. Ambrose carried out research that helped lead to the discovery at Harvard University. Rufkin researched at Massachusetts General Hospital and Harvard Medical School. At first, Ambrose and Rufkin were interested in genes that control when genetic developments take place. These developments ensure that different kinds of cells develop at the right time. The scientists studied the genetic material of a 1 millimeter long worm, C. elegans, which is commonly used for research. They studied two mutant strains of worms that displayed defects in the timing of activation of genetic programs during development. They wanted to identify the mutated genes in the worms and what the genes did. After some time, they finally found that microRNA controlled the mutation. They also believe that this mutation has permitted organisms to change or evolve over hundreds of millions of years. Dr. Claire Fletcher is a cancer researcher with Imperial College London. Fletcher said the discovery of microRNA has opened new ways for treating cancer. Fletcher said that microRNA provides genetic instructions that tell cells to make new proteins. MicroRNA alters how genes in the cell work, said Fletcher, who is not associated with the Nobel Prize. We can take a microRNA that we know alters the activity of that gene, and we can deliver that particular microRNA to cancer cells to stop that mutated gene from having its effect, Fletcher added. Last year's Nobel Prize in Medicine or Physiology was also awarded for developments related to RNA. Hungarian-American Katalin Kariko and American Drew Weissman were recognized for discoveries that enabled messenger RNA, or mRNA, vaccines for COVID-19. The Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine is valued at about $1 million. Swedish inventor Alfred Nobel established the Nobel Prizes to recognize important discoveries that have aided humanity. Thomas Perlman, is the Secretary General of the Nobel Committee. He said it took a long time before Rivkin came to the phone, but he was happy when he understood what it was all about. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
Body weight continues to be a big public health issue in the United States. New government research suggests that the condition of having far too much fat stored in the body, severe obesity, has increased greatly over the past 10 years. The U.S. obesity rate is about 40%. Says a 2021 to 2023 study of about 6,000 people. Almost 1 in 10 of those questioned reported severe obesity. The U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention found women were nearly 2 times as likely as men to report severe obesity. The overall obesity rate appeared to decrease in comparison to the 2017 to 2020 survey, but the change was not considered statistically meaningful. In other words, the numbers are small enough that there is a mathematical chance the rates did not truly drop.
Dr. Samuel Emmerich is the CDC public health officer who led the latest study. He said it is too soon to know whether new treatments for obesity, including weight loss drugs such as Wegovy and Zepbound, can help ease the disease. We simply can't see down to that detailed level to prescription medication use and compare that to changes in obesity prevalence, Emmerich said. He added, "Hopefully that is something we can see in the future." The results show that the overall obesity rate in the U.S. has not changed much in 10 years. The rate of severe obesity climbed from almost 8% in the 2013-2014 study to almost 10% in the most recent one. Before that, obesity had increased quickly in the U.S. since the 1990s, federal studies showed.
Measures of obesity and severe obesity are based on body mass index, or BMI, a computation involving height and weight. People with a BMI of 30 are considered obese. Those with a BMI of 40 or higher have severe obesity. Solveig Cunningham is an Emory University global health professor who specializes in obesity. Cunningham said, "Seeing increases in severe obesity is even more alarming, because that's the level of obesity that's most highly associated with some of the highest levels of cardiovascular disease and diabetes and lower quality of life." Cunningham, who was not involved in the new study, said it is not clear why rates of severe obesity are going up. Cunningham also said it is not clear why severe obesity rates were higher among women. Reasons could include the effects of hormones, the effects of childbearing, or other causes that require further study, she said. The new study also found that obesity rates varied by education. Almost 32% of people with a bachelor's degree or higher reported having obesity. In comparison, about 45% of those with some college or less had obesity.
The new report follows the release earlier this month of data from U.S. states and territories that showed that in 2023, the rate of obesity differed widely by place. The highest obesity levels were in West Virginia. Around 41% of adults in the state are obese. The lowest levels were in Washington, D.C., with less than 24% of adults being obese. Obesity rates were highest in the Midwest and the South. All U.S. states and territories had obesity rates higher than 20%. In 23 states, more than 1 in 3 adults had obesity, the data showed. Before 2013, no state had a rate that high, said Dr. Allison Goodman, who leads a CDC team focused on population health. Color-coded maps show the obesity rates across the U.S. Sometimes when you look at all that red, it's really discouraging, Goodman said. But, she added, recent attention on understanding obesity as a metabolic disease and new drug treatments give her hope. Preventing obesity is most important, Cunningham said, starting in early childhood. And for people already dealing with obesity, preventing additional weight gain should be the goal. I'm John Russell.
And I'm Ashley Thompson. Just heard this week's Health and Lifestyle Report. Now, John joins me to talk more about it. Hi, John. Welcome.
Hi, Ashley. Thanks for having me on the show.
In your opinion, what is the most interesting or useful word in this report?
I think the word prevalence is the most interesting and useful. Prevalence is a noun. It means the percentage of a population that is affected with a particular disease at a given time.
English learners are likely to encounter this term when they are reading news reports or studies about illnesses and diseases, right?
That's right. In our report, the term prevalence came in a quote from a researcher, Samuel Emmerich. He talked about obesity prevalence. Our listeners should also know that we often use the short word of after the term prevalence. So you might hear or read about the prevalence of heart disease, the prevalence of diabetes, and so on.
So we could say that our report was about the prevalence of obesity in the United States.
That's right.
All right. Thanks again for coming on the show today, John.
Thank you for having me. See you next time.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Ana Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
The biggest, the fastest, the youngest, and the oldest.
The most, the least, the worst, and the best.
All of these expressions you've just heard have that small word that is so important in English. In fact, it's the most common word in all of English.
And there it was again. Jill just said, the most common. On today's podcast lesson, we're looking at the word the when we use the superlative. The superlative describes something with the highest degree of a quality.
There it is again. You just said the highest degree. You see, we can't even talk about the superlative without using the word the.
Well, it's pretty hard to avoid using the word the. And I think our listeners probably already know about comparing things in English. For example, the Empire State Building in New York City is taller than the Eiffel Tower in Paris. And the Burj Al Khalifa is the tallest building in the world. We use the suffix ER for comparisons, like X is taller than Y.
But what has this got to do with Ana? It seems like we're digressing or getting away from the main topic.
We're almost digressing. But Ana mentions some superlatives when she visits a seafood market in Lesson 30 of the Let's Learn English series. Listen for the superlative in this example. You will hear the superlative used twice.
Hello! Washington, D.C. sits on the Potomac River. This river is important to the history and culture of the city. Today, I am at an outdoor seafood market near the Potomac River. Some say it is the oldest outdoor seafood market in the United States. I am here to buy seafood. Let's see what they have. Excuse me, can you help me?
Sure, what do you need?
Pete!
Ana!
What are you doing here?
I work here. You know, it's not easy to be a writer.
Yeah, I heard that. Sorry.
But this job is great. I work outside by the river, and I can eat all the free seafood I want.
That is great, Pete. In fact, I am here to buy some seafood for my dinner party.
You came to the right place. They have the freshest seafood in town.
Did you hear the superlative in that last sentence?
They have the freshest seafood in town.
And a bit earlier, Ana said,
some say it is the oldest outdoor seafood market in the United States.
The superlative adds the suffix EST to one-syllable adjectives or to two-syllable adjectives that end in the letter Y, like the word happy.
But what about an adjective with many syllables, like the word delicious? We can't say deliciousest. That's hard to pronounce.
Yeah, when the adjective is longer, usually two or more syllables, we just put the two words the most or the least before it. For example, we could say the most delicious or the least expensive. And here's another example with the adjective wonderful. There's a popular song in the U.S. for the Christmas holiday. It's called, It's the Most Wonderful Time of the Year.
Bum, 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 bum.
Coming back to Ana's visit to the seafood market, a bit later in Lesson 30, we hear this.
The crabs here are delicious. They are the best because they come from the nearby Chesapeake Bay. Walk this way. How many crabs do you want?
I want a dozen crabs.
You should get the larger crabs. They have the most meat.
You could hear the superlatives the best and the most. And if you were listening carefully, you might have noticed something that seems to break the rule of comparisons. Pete uses the word the before the comparative form with the er suffix.
You should get the larger crabs. They have the most meat.
Normally, we don't use the word the before the adjective in comparisons.
Right. We just say bigger, larger, taller, and so on. So, for example, a simple comparison would be, these crabs are larger than those crabs.
But if we already can see the two choices, and we already know which one is larger, then we identify one group by saying the larger ones.
That's right. The word the is used to identify things, among many other uses. It turns out the word the is quite useful in English.
That's true. There's another word Anna uses that our listeners should notice. It begins with the letter D. Listen.
How many crabs do you want?
I want a dozen crabs.
Pete asks how many. So we know that the word dozen, that's spelled D-O-Z-E-N, is a quantity. A quantity means an amount or a certain number of items. Listeners, do you know how many things are in a dozen? Here's a hint. In the U.S. and other countries, in the grocery store, eggs are often sold by the dozen.
And the answer is? Twelve!
Well, that was quite exciting. But knowing the expression a dozen or dozens can be useful. And not only when shopping for eggs. Many news reports, including those on the Learning English website, use the word dozen or dozens to describe how many things there are.
There's also a well-known movie called Cheaper by the Dozen, based on a book about an American family with 12 children.
And remember that there are dozens of episodes of the Let's Learn English series you can watch to help you learn English. And don't forget, on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com, each episode of Let's Learn English comes with a lesson plan you can download to help you learn more or even teach English to others.
Mm-hmm. And so you can get practice with superlatives, write to us at learningenglish@voanews.com and tell us about something in your town that is the biggest, tallest, oldest, or most interesting thing.
And thank you for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.